Good afternoon. I am Pastor Ariel Davis for the Corinth Missionary Baptist Church in the Chapel Hill community of Tyler, Texas. I'm delighted to come to you by way of this medium to share with you a word from the Lord. Since we're not able to gather at his house because of the situation we find ourselves in, we are more than delighted that there is another method for us sharing a word with you. Earlier, our associate, Dr. John Hart, was on with the Sunday school lesson. That video will be posted to the Corinth Baptist Church Facebook page. And I'm sure if you will tune into that, you will be blessed by his exposition of the Sunday school lesson. But now it's our responsibility and duty to share this word with you, which the Lord has shared with me. For our scriptural basis for the word today, we want to look at the Gospel of Mark, chapter 11, and verses 7 through 10. That is the Gospel of Mark, chapter 11, verses 7 through 10. And it says, "And they brought the colt to Jesus and cast their garments on him," the colt, "and he," Jesus, "sat upon him. And many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and strowed them in the way. And they that went before and they that followed cried, saying, 'Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.'" Amen. So read the word of God. Based on this text, we want to share with you from the subject of facing difficulty with confidence. In times such as this, we, the body of Christ, as all of our fellow members of this planet Earth, are faced with a terrific pandemic called COVID-19. And because of that, many people are scurrying and trying to figure out what to do and what positions they should take and how they should conduct themselves, and causing fear and panic in many during this time. But for us who are children of God, we should have a different approach to this difficulty. We need to learn how and exhibit the fact that we can face this difficulty and any difficulty with confidence. And we can do that when we know certain things. Now let's look at our text, because in our text, and before our text in the book of Mark, Jesus was facing a terrific, horrific difficulty, a horrific and difficult problem. He was facing physical abuse that would be caused by those who in this text and earlier shouted, "Hosanna." The same would be shouting, "Crucify him." And then he would be crucified, which is one of the cruelest methods of death known to man. This was a tremendous difficulty that he was facing. And it was a difficulty, not just a molehill, not just a rise in the horizon. It was a mountain kind of difficulty. It was a Mount Everest, or it was any major mountain, Pike's Peak, kind of difficulty that he was facing. And let's see how he handled it, because if we look at how he handled it and determine the reasons why he was able to handle it, it can be a benefit to us as we face our difficulties today and in the future. Jesus in the past had come into Jerusalem, but sometime he came in not quite so with a display of confidence. He came in under the cover of darkness. He came in unannounced. And even when he did miracles and helped persons along the way, many times he would tell them, "Don't tell anybody that I did this." But this time, his entrance was different. This time, he came into the city, not under cover of darkness, not unannounced. He came in staging his entrance to demonstrate this desire to exude confidence in the situation that he was facing. In our text, he sent his disciples as they came near to the city of Jerusalem to go into the city, and he would find a colt tied and loose him and bring the colt to him. And so if any man asks you why you're doing it, tell him the master has need of him. And they did that and brought the colt. And the reason Jesus wanted to do this, he wanted to go into Jerusalem with confidence and let the people know who he was and to accept them recognizing him as their king in fulfillment of the prophecy of Zechariah 9:9. So when he came in with a great fanfare that he himself staged. And when he came in, the people shouted Hosanna. They took and strode down leaves and branches, making in effect a red carpet for him. And they said, "Hosanna, Hosanna, save us now. Hosanna in the highest, and blessed is he who come in the name of the Lord." They gave him great accolades. This is what he sought. This was a demonstration of the confidence that he had as he faced this horrific difficulty that was before him. Now, after he came in with this great fanfare and display of confidence, he went to the temple and he looked around and saw the same thing in the temple then that he saw at the beginning of his ministry. He saw men who were misusing his temple and using it for their own purposes, buying and selling and exchanging. So he left and went and spent the night, came back the next morning, cursed the fig tree on the way in. And when he got there, he whipped them out, turned over their tables and cast them out of the temple. This was indeed a display of confidence and boldness. And he wanted them to know that he was able to do this, even though he knew what he was facing in a short time from now. The question is, why was he able to display such confidence and boldness? Why did he choose to do this now? What caused him to be able to demonstrate this? Because if we can discover why he was able to do it, and he is our example, it might be beneficial to us as we face our difficulties now and in the future. Let's look at it. There are some things that Jesus knew that gave him the ability to exude this confidence. And if we can know these same kind of things, it can prepare us for whatever difficulty we face in life. First of all, Jesus knew that he was in the family of God. He was a part of the Godhead even in eternity past when it was decided how the earth would be made and formed, how the universe would develop, how the plan of salvation for man would be designed. He was a part of the Godhead way back then. And he demonstrated even currently that he was a member of the Godhead as exemplified in John 3:16, where it said that, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son," his only begotten son, a member of the Godhead and in the family of God, "that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life." This is another indication that Jesus knew that he was in the family of God. And being in the family of God gives us a special kind of assurance, a special kind of confidence, a special kind of boldness, just knowing that we're in the family of him who has all power in his hand. He who is the creator, who has all knowledge, he who's everywhere, who has all power, just knowing that we're in his family can give us a certain kind of confidence, even in our earthly existence. knowing that I was in my father's family. My father was a great provider, protector of the family. And knowing that I was in that family, and when he was in the house, I got a special kind of confidence. All of my fears were cast away. I felt a boldness that nothing could happen to me. I was invincible because I knew I was in the family and under the protective care of my father. So each of us need to make sure that we know that we are in the family of God, that we have done what is necessary to be saved, delivered from the consequences of our sins, which is a destination in hell, rescued from that and given us a seat in the kingdom. And when God rescues us, he also adopts us into his family. We don't have anything to do with that. Once we do what we need to do to be saved, he then rescues us or saves us. And when he saves us, he brings us into the family as heirs and co-heirs with Jesus Christ. Oh, what a magnificent understanding and feeling that is, to realize that we are in the family of God. We're not on the outside looking in. We're on the inside, and the beneficiary and the benefactor of all that comes with being in God's family. So that's the first thing. Jesus understood and knew that he was in the family of God. And if we want to be able to face our difficulties with confidence, we need to make sure that we are in the family of God and we know it. Therefore, it engenders in us a kind of confidence that when we face difficulties, we can have this calm assurance that I am in the family of God. The second thing that Jesus knew that we need to understand is he knew that he was in the will of God. That is shown in John chapter 5 and verse 30. When Jesus said, I can of my own do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just because I see not my own will, but the will of my Father which is in heaven, which means that he only did the will of God, and doing the will of God puts you in the will of God. And when you're in the will of God, oh, what a precious position to be in. That means you're in fellowship with God. And when you're in fellowship with God, you're able to enjoy all the benefits that God has for us in this life. We come under his protection. We have his provisions. We have the sense of calmness and a sense of joy in the midst of confusion and peace in the midst of trouble. When we are in the family of God and in the will of God. So each of us need to make sure that we are in the will of God. And if something happens that calls us to be knocked out of the will of God, and sin will do that, God has given each one of us who's ever been in his will what I call a monkey wrench, a way to fix any broken relationship with him. And that monkey wrench for us is repentance. For when we repent, it takes care of any problem that we have had that calls us to be out of the will of God. It brings us back into the will of God, and God will embrace us and forgive us and love us again and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And oh, what a joy it is to be back in fellowship with God and enjoy all the benefits of being a member of the family of God. So first of all, Jesus knew he was in the family of God. And we need to make sure that we have done all that we need to do to be in God's family. And once we're in the family of God, then we need to make sure that we stay in the will of God. And if something should happen to knock us out of the will of God, because we're all tempted and sooner or later we're going to all sin. And the Bible says, he who says he has no sin right now, you're just fooling yourself. So when sin comes on us, that breaks our fellowship with God. That takes us out of the will of God. But God gave us the ability to get back in the will of God through the medium of repentance. Repentance means that we regret and we're sorry for the sin that we offended God. and that we turn from our sin, being sorry for the fact that we sinned and offended God, and turn toward God and change our mind about our sin, then God is just to forgive us and cleanse us and of all unrighteousness and love us again as his children. So two things. Number one, he knew he was in the will of God. Number two, he knew he was in the family of God. And then the third thing that Jesus did and knew, which is recorded in Luke chapter 9, 51, he said, and it came to pass when the time was come that he, Jesus, should be received up. He steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. This means that he understood and knew that he had finished working the work that God had assigned to his hands to do. So he knew he was in the family of God. He knew he was in the will of God. And he knew he had done the work that God has assigned to his hands to do. If we do not do the work that God has assigned to our hands to do, that is in effect a sin, and that's failing to do what we ought to do, which is unrighteousness, and it breaks our fellowship with God, moves us out of the will of God. But when we have done the work that God has assigned to our hands to do, it creates in us a wonderful feeling, a wonderful assurance, a wonderful understanding of acceptance, and we can approach God with confidence, knowing that I'm in his family, I'm in his will, and I have done what he has assigned to my hands to do. I can remember the time when my father assigned chores to me, and when I had done the chores that he had signed, when I knew I had done them and done them to his satisfaction, I could approach my father with a great deal of confidence, knowing that whatever I ask of him that was within his power, that he would do for me. I could approach him with confidence. And likewise, when we know that we have done what Jesus has assigned to our hands to do, we can face whatever comes our way, knowing that we are in his family, knowing that we're in his will, and knowing that we have done the work, therefore we can have confidence to face whatever comes against us. And then there's one last thing as I prepare to close. And this comes in the book of Luke chapter 22. And this is verse 42. This is recorded when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, when sweat like drops of blood ran down, and he cried out, Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me. And he asked the Father three times, and on the third time, or each time, he came to the thing that all of us need to come to. Each of us, somewhere in our spirit, no matter what we ask of God, we need to have in our spirit a nevertheless, which means that this is what I want, but nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And the reason he could do that is because he knew that God would not put more on him than he could handle. But with every test or with every burden, God would make a way for us to escape or bear it. And Jesus knew this, so therefore he knew that no matter what happened, God would take care of him. And just knowing that God would take care of you will give you a kind of confidence that allows you to face any difficulty with confidence and assurance and with boldness. That's what the Hebrew boys did. They knew they were in the family of God and in the will of God. And they knew they had done the work of God. So when they faced a fiery furnace, they had confidence that God would take care of them. And they declared, O King, I don't have to be careful how I answer you, for the God I serve will take care of me. I know he can deliver me, and he will deliver me. But then they said, nevertheless, even if he doesn't, I'm not going to bow to you. I'm going to stay with him, because they knew that God will take care of him. And each of us will need to know have that confidence to face whatever when we realize and understand and know for sure we are in the family of God and that we are in the will of God and that we have done the work that God has assigned to us, then we can have the assurance that God will take care of us. It does not matter what comes against us, whatever betide, we know that God will take care of us. That will allow us to face any difficulty and hold on to our witness and hold on and tell a dying world as we face our difficulty that there is a reality in serving the true and the living God. So children, no matter who we are going to have difficulties in this life. Any man is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. In this life, you will have difficulties and persecution, but we can face them with confidence so that when those who are not in the family of God can look at us and say, man, how can you do that? How can you face your difficulties and be so calm and be so confident? Then we can tell them with certainty, I can do it because I know that I am in the family of God. I can do it because I know I am in the will of God. I can do it because I know I have done what God assigned to my hands to do. Therefore, I know that God will take care of me. And I can tell you how you can be like I am. Oh, what a wonderful invitation to witness to somebody who's not in the family of God. And we can do that with confidence and face whatever we face, this pandemic, whatever else that we face. And many of us who are in the family of God have most likely already been affected by and healed from this pandemic without even knowing we had it, because we are in the family of God, because we are in the will of God, because we are doing the work that God has assigned to our hands to do. Therefore, we know that God, no matter what, that God will take care of us. Hallelujah. That's enough to shout about right here. That's enough to share with somebody, especially in time like this, and give us the ability to face our difficulties today and in the days to come with the kind of confidence that let the world know that I have a God who can. Well, bless you. It's our joy to have been able to bring this message to you today. And we look forward to doing this every Sunday from now on. And even on Wednesdays, we intend to share on Facebook with our Bible study and training at noon on Wednesdays. So look forward for that. And then for the members of the church, we have our prayer line. And we will be sharing it on the prayer line as well. Then there are CDs that are available. All we need to do is to call the church, to come by the church, and someone will be there or someone will be willing to share with you how you can get us a CD. Or if you call me at 903-399-2929, I would be glad to share that information with you. So until this time, next time, I'm going to say God bless you, God keep you, do all you can to stay safe, and protect yourself and your family. And in the meantime, make sure you know that you are in the family of God, that you are in the will of God, that you have done what the work that God has assigned to your hands to do. And therefore, you will know that God will take care of you. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer.